Okay, let's start. So Shannon's willing little under the weather again. So I'm going to cover what. Okay, I didn't look at the video of last lecture. Can you guys tell me where did he stop exactly? The last lecture, did he finish the Hawkins phase approach?
Okay,
so, okay, good. So, I think what I will do today is I will go over the Occam's razor proof again, formalize a little bit about the intuition of connecting it to the back learnability, and then the next lecture is some examples of which kind of hypothesis and which kind of function learning is back learnable. So, I'll show some examples of that. So let's start with Occam's razor. This is about to go a little bit fast. And I think, again, we'll be ending slightly sooner than expected. I'm not sure, though. But if I do, then you guys have any questions about the assignment or more importantly, the projects, then I could take them. Yeah, so let's start with Occam's razor. So Occam's razor, Occam was, I think, there was this guy called William, and he was a priest in Auckland, and he proposed this philosophy. Essentially, we know that simple is best. So, it's one of the philosophical principles. There is no math behind it, but people have taken this principle, applied it to several different areas, and formalized it more mathematically, and supposed to work pretty nicely. It's logical as well. If there is a simpler explanation available to a phenomena, you would pick that over a complicated one. That's essentially the gist of it, that simple is best, or prefer simple explanations over complex ones. Yeah, so this is Occam's razor, and now we will see, forgetting about, like, keeping in mind a standard definition of concept class, hypothesis class, the distribution of data, and the epsilon and deltas, we will try to put this in math terms. So basically, what we want to do, so in the slides it's given in the reverse order. Shannon goes ahead to explain the math first and then relates it back to how Occam's razor is apparent in this. But let's start with some basic things. It is obvious that your training is going to be hard, more complex your hypothesis classes. So what we want to do here is we want to prove by using this principle that simpler hypothesis class H generalizes less complex, less training, and yeah, I think there's one. Yeah, but we can get to that. So we are trying to achieve this, and now we will push in the forward direction is to have to put this in terms. What we do is we start with the claim that, let's first define what a bad hypothesis is. H belongs to H. Yes. So bad hypothesis is that one that works well in your training set, but it doesn't generalize when I put in a new data, which is not something you want. So how do we quantify this? First, of course, the error over the distribution of hypothesis. This we covered. This is the probability of target function f of x. This is for sample x, not equal to the hypothesis prediction. Yes. So this is the error, and this is greater than epsilon. So the generalizability of the hypothesis is not that great. And the other thing is, like if we have a shitty hypothesis, then even if it doesn't generalize well, if it doesn't perform well in our training, we would definitely ignore it. But we are looking at such cases which performs consistently with what our training examples are, but still performs bad when a new example is given. So that point bullet would come under it being consistent. And this word would come up again and again, consistent with training set, the M training example. Yeah, so basically it says this hypothesis is consistent with what we did with our M training examples, but it is still bad. So now we want to say, we want to have some theorems on this. So the claim is, let me try to define consistent if I can. Yeah, so consistent sort of mathematically means that for M examples, x1 to xm, f of x1 is approximately like super close to h of xi. So basically the hypothesis predicts the function on these training examples to a really nice accuracy. Keep this in mind when you think about what consistent means. And by this definition, you can say that the consistent is on certain set of examples. It's not a general thing. You give a set of examples, any given hypothesis is consistent. So this is the other stuff. Let me use a different color. Yes, our claim is that the probability of bad hypothesis which belongs to H, we call it PB of H, is less than this thing. And now we'll go ahead and prove that, and we'll also sort of see how that relates to Occam's razor. So, let me stop here. People are sort of clear on how we go from this philosophical idea to generating, we want to eliminate bad hypothesis. So there is a thin line here, is because we want simpler hypotheses, we want some kind of bound on what a bad hypothesis could be, and that's why that bound would have terms which would say these points, that given set of training example, if we assume our hypothesis class to be small and simpler, then we would require less time. So this is it. Let's start with proof. So the first step in the proof is fairly simple. Just like you need to put it in, and I guess you guys have done that. So can anyone tell me what the first step is? Yeah, I'm like stressing on this proof because this is the kind of proof that might come in like one of your assignments, slightly modified version of this, you change some assumptions and stuff. So you need to know like what kind of a general structure the proof follows. So okay, so the first thing we think about is we start, if you don't know how to solve a problem, make it simple. Again, the cycling concept. We start with one example. If you have one example, and we have a hypothesis H, which is bad. Okay, so we start with two things. We have hypothesis H belongs to the hypothesis class H, and this is bad. Bad means it follows these things. And second, let's say X belongs to the training set S, and we are working on this one. And this was in the training set. Yeah, so keep in mind. So because hypothesis is bad, it means it is consistent. So this holds for all the X's in that set. So basically, error over this hypothesis is so this is greater than epsilon. And error, if you just consider one example, this is probability of fx not being equal to h of x. This is greater than epsilon. Then we can see if this is not equal to, like, we could definitely write this as probability of f of x being equal to h of x greater than epsilon. Now what is this? This is the is less than 1 minus epsilon. So we start with this, and why did we start with this is because we want this thing, because that highlights our consistent assumption. And now we have a small additional assumption that we will always make, which is that all the samples drawn from the training set are independent. And so we could say that if the hypothesis H is consistent, it is consistent with all the examples x1 to xm. And as they are drawn independently, we could say that the probability of hypothesis H on the training set S, and this is the probability of the fx being equal to hx, is less than 1 minus m raised to n, because all these are independent. Okay, we are almost done, but where does that this cardinal number of h comes from? That is fairly simple, because we did everything for a single hypothesis from the hypothesis class H, which we assume to be bad. So this is the probability that some hypothesis H from H is bad, and is bad means consistent with an example. I don't need to restate it. Then, if you want to say that there exists such a probability, because this probability, I should have written it in a more formal way, okay? Probability of bad hypothesis there exists should be here. Probability there exists a bad hypothesis H in H is this much. And so this there exists begs the question, how many number of hypotheses are there in the entire hypothesis class H? And that simply is the cardinal number. So we just say that the probability that a bad hypothesis H can exist within our chosen hypothesis class is less than the number of total hypotheses and the probability that total hypothesis, this is since probability that each of these hypotheses H is bad, which is on the training set S. So essentially, this is given by this, and this we can compute here. This is equal to, and because of this less than it, it's this less. So hence proof. Okay, so this claim is proven. Now, what do we do with this claim? What's a generic strategy of having this probability which is not good for us? What is the generic strategy? Yep.
Can I ask a question before we go on?
Yeah, go ahead.
So the last, the...
This one?
Yeah. That's the probability that there exists,
yep.
And some bad hypothesis.
Yes.
The line before that in black?
Yes.
This is saying the probability that there is one bad hypothesis?
Right. No, this is the probability that there is an hypothesis H, which is bad, on the training set S. So for a singular one, you're right.
But is it the probability that a given hypothesis is bad, or is it the probability that there exists a bad hypothesis?
Yeah, it's the given one, because we start with the assumption that there is a bad hypothesis.
Okay, so given some H,
yeah,
the probability that it's a bad assumption is 1 minus epsilon to the n.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yep.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, so repeating the question. Okay, people are clear for this. Any more questions for this proof? Okay, moving on. So what do we do with these kind of bad probabilities? Like, what do we want? Do we want it to be small? Do we want it to be big? Do we want some kind of control over it?
We want it to be small.
Yes. And small being good, if you were there in my previous class, I said there is two things. This is the bad part, and then there is the good part. The good is this bad thing is less than something, and that something comes in form of data. So once you are done with this proof, so proof concludes here. Hence proof. We said that we want this probability of there existing a bad hypothesis in our hypothesis class to be less than some small number delta. Yeah, and we have a bound on this, so we essentially want this thing. This is just simple math, and then simplifying this and putting one of the standard algebraic inequalities, we get this equation. M is greater than 1 over delta, I guess. Sorry, no, 1 over epsilon. And log of cardinality of the hypothesis class plus log of 1 by delta. Yeah, so this looks fairly similar to what we proved for conjunctions. This thing we got is interesting, because this term, if you think about it carefully, says that if we have a more complex hypothesis class, which means there are more number of functions which exist inside this hypothesis class, which means this number is higher, then we would require more training examples, because this thing would be used. That is essentially this, right? If we have a simpler H, which means cardinality of H is small, then we will need less training. And the second thing, which is kind of like a cyclic explanation, is that if you want the generalizability to be well, now what parameter here refers to generalizability? That is the epsilon. So because there is no bad hypothesis, then the error, the inequality sign would be flipped. And so we want, if we want a small generalizability error, which is error d over an h, then again we need more training examples. So yeah, so I was wrong here. A simpler h just means less training. And then there are, so this is the only part which is like directly related to Occam's razor, but there are additional information in this equation. One being, if we want the system to be more generalizable, then we will have to increase our training set size. Also, if we want the, more confidence in there being no bad probabilities, then again we will have to increase our training set. And I think that concludes for the Occam's razor. And I think the final slide here says there's a very nice statement that. So after all this analysis, what we can say is that, I'm just reading up the slide here. Let H be a hypothesis space, then with probability 1 minus delta, probability 1 minus delta, a hypothesis small h belonging to hypothesis class H is consistent with the training set of size m and will have an error less than epsilon on all future examples if m satisfies this. So that's essentially the punchline of all these things. This relates to from this definition. Basically, we can have like a more general scheme for pack learning. Remember, in pack learning, what we wanted was the training examples to have a bound which is polynomial in 1 by epsilon, 1 by delta, size of the hypothesis class, and the dimension n. Well, n is not featured here, but the other things, it is polynomial n because you can express each log as a polynomial series. Okay, so before going into the examples of the back learnability, I would like to say, whenever you are given a question about whether a given class of function, given class of hypothesis, and given a learner, you want to see if this learner is learnable, then the first thing you will have to do is take the hypothesis class and compute this. And that would require some kind of combinatorics. So, especially like you'll figure out like, when we discuss the questions here. Yeah, so the lecture 15 is essentially titled as "What Can Be Learned." So let's go for the first example. The first example is we want to learn general convergence. We want to see these are path learnable. And for path learnable, we will need to calculate the hypothesis class H. The interesting part is, even though we find this quantity log of cardinality in H, in most cases, the cardinality of H would be some function of the dimension of your data, which is n. Let's say you have an n-dimensional variable. N number of variables, not the dimension. I did that right. N number of variables would feature in this. And remember that for pack learnability, m needs also to be a polynomial in the number of variables n. So given that, let me ask you guys this combinatorics question, that if a general conjunction, there is a general conjunction, then each hypothesis would look something like, let's say the training set is x1 to xn. You are given n variables. Each of these are Boolean. So the hypothesis function x could maybe look like negation of x1, function x2. This could be one of them. So this would be one of the functions, and now I want you to give me an answer. Give me an answer how many such functions exist. Given that you are training set of n examples, and each example has n variables, each of these variables are Boolean, how many such hypothesis functions, let's call this H1, you can construct? Close, but not true. 2 to the n is the obvious answers, because each variable could be expressed by that or its negation. And we have n such variables, then 2 to the power n. But the thing is, each variable is not just expressed by itself and its negation, but it's also expressed by itself, its negation, and not exist in the function itself. Like in this case, like everything from x3 to xn does not exist. So considering that state of the variable, we would see that it's 3 to the power n, not 2 to the power n. Except for this example, in most cases, when we are given n variables, we will assume that function has all the variables. There cannot be a function where a variable is missing. But in this case, we are assuming, I'm just going by the slides. You could also ask the same question that if we have our hypothesis class is general conjunctions which features all the variables, then you would be right that it is just 2 power n. So now given this, so this is the cardinality of H. So log of this H in log is in base 2. Log is in ln. It could be in base 2, but it doesn't matter. So it's O log ln 3 of this. So this is a polynomial in N. And hence the bound on the training examples would be polynomial in N. The number of examples needed would be replaced just by N log 3. And that would be your answer. So it is packable. Then the questions in assignment would be, they will give you some specific values for N, delta, and epsilon. And you will have to compute how many training iterations you will have, how many training examples you. So that's fairly simple, and you can basically see if you compute this fixing an epsilon and delta, it linearly increases with n, which is obvious. Okay, so let's go for a more complex example. So people are clear on this. This is the most important part. I think everything else makes sense.
So I just have like
a bigger question. We're not saying this is pack learnable, right? We're just saying we would need that many training samples to achieve the balance.
We are saying that it could be learned in a consistent manner with training examples being only polynomial in N. So the sample consistency is there, which is one of the assumptions in pack learnable.
Okay, cool. So, can I ask a side question?
Yeah, go ahead.
So, is the concept class, the size of concept class of this family, of the conjunction, also related to one in this case? Concept class?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, the concept class and that of this. Do you guys, has Sangin covered conjunctive normal form? Like, do you know what 3CNF are? Okay, well, it's pretty simple. Like, let me define it. Okay, so you are given, again, you are given n Boolean variables. And you are learning a Boolean function. This is a Boolean function. This essentially means, let's see, x1 to xn variables, then a conjunctive normal form looks something like this. In this one, we are assuming all the n variables are used. So it looks like something like this. x1, distended with some x2, x3. There is 3 tuple. There would always be a tuple with 3 variables. And this is in conjunction with some other 3 tuple, A, B, C, let's say. Okay, all these belong to the training class. These are called conjoints, I believe. I'm not sure what I'm talking about. Conjoint, yeah. So conjunct, these 3 tuples are called conjunct. And this is the 3CNF form. You can have a general KCNF form. So, okay, this is harder. How many conjunct, so what is the, so again, we want to ask the question, what is the size of hypothesis class H? So how do you think we should proceed? Okay, so let's just think that in how many ways can we choose 3 variables from N to form for each conjunct? We don't care about how the variables are expressed, but from a set of variables, you have to choose 3. So it's just N choose 3. But the trick here is, we dummify, if that's a word, the variables. I said that all of these are expressed in the function, so, and each of these contain exactly 3. So the number of variables are not n, they are 2n. The number of variables would be x1, negation of x1, x2, negation of x2, and so on. These are 2n variables. And if we choose any 3 of these, 3 from this, and form a conjunction like this, and then combine all such conjunctions, that is a valid way to do it. So let's just say, what is the number of ways you can choose 3 variables from this 2n variables, which is simply 2nc3, and this is some function of n cubed, right? This is O n cubed. And the rest is simple. You do exactly, now forget about this 3 tuple. just call this entire thing A, call this entire thing B, and all you have is how many ways we can form such functions, which is 3 to the power n, which we just did. Right? Because all these are again Boolean variables, and they are in some factor of n. So the total hypothesis size is 3 power instead of n. So in the slide it says 2, so it's taking all these to exist and not never not exist, which kind of makes sense because they're dummy. So 2 raised to ON3, I guess, because these many ways you can choose a 3. So that many variables. Instead of an n, it's replaced by how many combinations are there. Okay. Do people, I know this is kind of tricky, but do people understand this combinatorics here? Okay, so going on. Again, you can see if you take the log here, then log of h is O is q. So it's again polynomial in n and consistent with this formula here. Like saying that the training is the sample complexity of the training is polynomial in number of variables.
I wonder why the base is 2.
Yeah, so the base is 2. Okay, so when we were learning the previous example, each variable has a choice not to exist. In this case, do you think A has a choice not to exist? Because if it is so, we would not take that in the combination itself. So that's why it could be only A or not A. It's the same way as the as what we did with the general conjunction, and that's why two. Each factor exhibits 2 Boolean states. Cool. Yep.
What about when you're like choosing the variables? Like, wouldn't it be 3 then?
So that's why I said that we are working in the assumption that these are exactly 3. Like, there would be 3 functions here. If we work under the assumption that x3 does not exist, then the function is only like this, the 2. So they are not under 3CNF. Well, 3CNF has many definitions. One of the definition is at most 3. One of the definition is exact 3. We are working with exact definition. If not, then yeah, there would be 3 n variables there, and then we are. Okay, so there is one more variation on this, which is given in the slide, which I'm not going to cover. Let's try to cover one of the negative examples in this, where it's exponential in n. Okay, so this is slightly more tricky. If I say that you are given n Boolean variables, how many Boolean functions exist? Like now, the hypothesis class is not just 3CNF, it's all Boolean functions on n variables.
Since we have all Boolean functions for each input, there's two the n different outputs.
Just two outputs. It could be the same.
Inputs.
Yeah. So then, if the answer is 2 to 2 power n, which is the size of the structure. So what he said. So any function f, if you map from a domain and a range, let's say this has n points and this has m points. Then how many, so function is essentially a mapping from input to output, right? So how many such mappings exist? So. Yeah, so mappings is let's forget about this. Let's start from how many number of combinations of inputs that you have, which is this. Okay, the number of combinations. And because each function f taking an input x1 to xn can produce only 0 or 1. We would have something corresponding to if function is outputting 0 for each of the 2n inputs, or function is outputting 1 for each of the 2n inputs. So that's 2 raised to 2 raised to n. And so this is clearly exponential, like log of hypothesis class size is exponential n. Yeah, and so that's the negative example. And because it does not follow this, this is a weaker condition than the back. If the hypothesis class does not follow the sample complexity, then it is not calculable. Because this is definitely, like, just proving this will not mean it is back, but disproving this will definitely mean it's not back. And yeah, that's it. And there are like 4 more examples. They are not described at all in detail, and they are supposed to be in exercises. I think 2 of them are in your next assignment. I'm not sure. So that's the same thing you have to do, is like you will need to do some kind of combinatorics to find out log of h, and you will be given a delta and a sigma as epsilon, and you have to compute the change size. So there is one statement which is made here. It's more detailed in slides, but the punchline essentially means that even if we prove that a learner algorithm or a hypothesis class has a reasonable training set requirements, which is the sample complexity, it does not mean that it's efficient, because we haven't considered about time efficiency at all. Yeah. So there is an example here. They have not proved the time accuracy, but they just state that the learning of KCNF, which is the 3CNF, the algorithm, the first algorithm which was provided was an NP-hard problem. So it's not, even though it's sample complexity is fairly easy, but the time complexity is bad. Yeah, and that mostly concludes lecture 15. I'm sure Shanyan will revise some of this. Yep, that's it. Any questions?
Yep, just more in general, but do you, and maybe this was said last time, but do you know what lectures the midterm will cover, like up to which lecture?
I'm not sure, but I am sure that the last thing that I covered here is not in the course. What I will do is I will go, I will mail Shandian, and then I will put an announcement on campus.
Do you think it's probably just through Perceptron?
Yeah, it should be probably through Perceptron. There could be like one minor objective type maybe question or path or something like that.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what you said last time.
Oh, he did?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. It might be a little, like, really conceptual question about that.
But nothing crazy.
Yeah. And it's really similar to the homework.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Good to know.
Yeah, exams won't be hard. I took this class.
They won't be hard, or they
won't? It won't be hard.
Oh.
Yeah. So as long as you understand your concepts, it won't be hard. There would be one question which would be slightly tricky, but the rest of it should be obvious if you understand. Cool. Any other questions? Cool. When is your report due? The project report?
Tonight.
Is it done?
What is it you're looking to have done for the project? Because it says not collect data, that won't be enough, so.
Basically, we try something and then tell you.
Okay, so I think what's expected from you is not just collect your data, but, okay, even if you haven't tried any concrete algorithms, but as long as you have analyzed data out there, there are like this many, the variants of the labels are like this, or something like that. The distribution is like that. Put some kind of information about that. Based on that information, maybe provide some kind of logical approach you are going to follow for the down the road. In project, if you have tried an algorithm, that's great, but yeah. So just a bit of general level, but who all are working on the classification problems? And who all are working on the regression problems? Nice. So advice for regression people, try linear regression. It's one line in Python on MATLAB. Okay? Advice for classification people, try perceptron. You don't need to write your own code. You could try it in MATLAB's parallels functions. You could use that for now. There might be, is there a simple unit class version of perceptron? You could try 9 days or TSM browser.
You
might
be perceptron and decision.
Yeah, this is increased.
My question is an election. And it's we're predicting the class distribution does vary, or like 1% of the